He normally works with Miles Davis. This is Branford Marsalis, the sax player. Who's that? Oh, that's Kenny Kirkland. He plays the keyboards with Wynton Marsalis. That's Omar Hakim, who normally works with Weather Report. That's Janice Pendarvis. Next to her is Dolette McDonald, who worked with the police.
Is this some attempt on your part, Gordon, to
who's this Gordon character?
Gordon. Isn't that your name, Sting, Gordon?
Yeah, everyone calls me Sting. My
you
mother.
You prefer that, do you?
My children call me Sting.
Right. I was just asking you whether this is some attempt for you to return to your roots.
Well, in reality, the first rock band I ever played in was the police. Before that, I'd worked extensively in different kinds of jazz group. My first band was a Dixieland trad group where I played double bass. So I feel in many ways at home with jazz players.
Is there going to be another album?
Use the microphone. It doesn't work.
I'm sorry.
I'm going to use this one.
Yes?
Right.
Okay. So I just wanted to ask you if you like France, if you would like to live in France, and secondly, if you would like to play with a French director, I mean, the best one.
I'd like to play with the best French director. Well, that's a leading question. I do like France. I mean, one of the reasons I came here to do this was because I think France has a certain ambiance. A certain neutrality, in a way.
Why are you making a film about this? Tell us.
See, what the film is actually about is the beginning of this group, is the formation of this group. It's about musicians from different areas forming a common language. Most rock films are made about bands when they're at the peak of their career, or when they're finished, when it's the last waltz or Let It Be. I can't think of a film that is about a band starting off, beginning.
If you need somebody, free, free, set them free, call my name.
Free, free, set them free.
If you want someone,
free, free, set them free,
you can do the same.
Free, free, set them free.
If you want to keep something precious,
free, free, set
my philosophies about music is that popular music, anyway, is that it's dead. And one of the reasons it's dead is it's become very reactionary and racist, where black musicians are not really given the opportunity to be heard on white radio or in white publications, and it's just as bad the other way. This band, being made up racially as it is an open challenge to that system.
Someone to despise.
I'm sure some people, some real purists, jazz people don't like the idea of us doing this, but I have another attitude about that, you know. I think that if you're a musician, you should try to play whatever you can play. You should try to cover all the music, you know.
Set them free. Set them free.
Set them free.
Set them free.
Set them free.
Set them free.
Set them free. Set them free.
Free.
Okay.
I think what we should do at that point...
With the vocals, the background vocals?
Tighten the vocals.
You can't control an independent lover.
So it comes from the second one.
No, it's singing unison with me, first of all. You can't control... Right? You sing you can't control,
oh,
and then do your bit.
Okay.
And then sing the next line with me. Mm. Sing what you can of my part.
Okay.
In your octave? In your octave? There's more than one octave. This is new.
They talked more and more about the band and who they were going to get and this and that. So finally, I chime in again. Well, you found your drummer. And he looks at me and goes, no, you didn't. And I said, yes, you did. And he says, who? And I said, me. And so he pulls his knife and fork. You know, he pulls a fork out of his mouth and he hands me a knife and a fork and says, Well, go ahead and play some at the table, and we had a good laugh from that night.
No life is no life. No life is no life.
Here I come, Dolette.
No.
One of the main things that I did before I was singing was I was a junior high school English teacher. I guess for me, the thing that I like about this music is that it's both, for me, cerebral and visceral. It gives you something to think about, but it also gives you something that you can feel, which to me is the ideal combination.
Tell me about some of the jobs you had before this.
I was receptionist in a house of prostitution. I was what they called the phone girl. And I got $5 for every man that I got to come into this house. And on a good day, I made about $100 for 7 hours work, which isn't bad because there were no taxes taken out. And I had to, it was my first real acting job because I had a script that I worked from. And I had to answer 7 phones, which had call waiting, which meant that I answered 12 phones. And I had to explain to each person what I would do to them once they got there.
You sing a third, you sing a fifth, I'll sing the tonic. The okay. Same with barbed wire, same with bridge, the same with chasm or chasm.
No,
chasm. It was chasm yesterday.
Yeah.
And then, on fire.
Just the last word of every line.
The last part, around your heart.
Oh, around your heart. Okay.
I'll show you. If I've built this fortress around your heart. Now, full voice. One. 2, 3, 4.
If I built this fortress around your heart and circled you in trenches and barbed wire, let me build a bridge for I cannot fill the chasm, and let me set the battlements on fire.
Let's do it. Full ensemble.
1, 2, 3, 4. If I built this fortress around your heart and circles you in trenches and barbed wire.
I was 7 and I got a clarinet, right? And which was cool. You know, and I was big enough to withstand the sissy jokes and the wimp jokes that go with being a clarinet player, you know. So it really, I played that until I was 14, and then I finally decided I wanted to play the saxophone, because the thing that I noticed is that you could get women with a saxophone, you know.
And let me build a bridge, or I cannot build a chasm. Let me set the
first time I went on a major tour was with Art Blakey. I was 19, playing baritone saxophone in his big band. I hated it. I hated playing baritone, not playing with Art Blakey. Playing with Art Blakey is great. He's one of the greatest musicians of all time. But playing baritone sax is the worst. I mean, you just can't imagine, you know, carrying a saxophone is bad, but the baritone saxophone is like 4.5 feet high. And to carry that thing around, and right in the middle of the tour, the strap on the case broke, and the saxophone hit the ground in the Frankfurt airport. Shit went everywhere, right? So I was picking up pieces and rubber banding things together. So for half of the tour, we actually did a record, and I was playing that horn, and like the notes didn't work, and you know, it was terrible.
I'm not so totally sure yet that that this is a band in that everyone has a totally equal say in what happens. I am curious to know whether it will eventually become that.
Fade it out.
You made it with that same chord?
Yeah.
That same chord?
Let me finish on the major seventh chord.
One of the great things about my life is that I haven't the faintest idea what I'm going to be doing in a year's time. One of the reasons I left teaching was that it was very easy to see the next 10 years of my life. You know, I could become the deputy headmaster and I could almost see the way I would look and the way I would behave. And then 10 years beyond that, I'd become the headmaster in this little school. And that was a nightmare. I much prefer not knowing what's around the corner.
At the still point of destruction, at the center of the fury, all the angels, all the devils, all around us, can't you see? There is a deeper way than this, swimming in the world.
Okay.
I'll sing with Acapulco.
At the still point of destruction, at the center of the fury, all the angels, all the devils, all around us, can't you see?
See, you did the first three down, and you did the last one up. You said basic.
Expect me to be consistent as well.
The center of the fury, all the angels, all the devils, all around us, can't you see?
I'm still not.
Can't you see? Well, let's just keep doing it.
At the still point of destruction.
Whoa. It's really syncopated. It's like right against the beat. 1, 2, 3, 4.
At the still point of destruction, at the center of the fury, all the angels, all the devils, all around us, can't you see?
Yeah, there's still some like weird.
So can I do that one and you do the one you were doing and let me just hear?
As long as it obeys the basic rules of harmony, you can do what you like.
At the still point of destruction, at the center of the fury, all the angels, all the devils, all around us, can't you see?
What did you sing, Dolette?
Can't you see? La 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 la.
Oh, by the way, this is...
This is what it gave me.
What effect are these new people having on Sting?
I think they're having a tremendous effect on him. He's very happy. He's very funny. He's lightened up a lot. He's not reading so many books.
Are you ever surprised by the way life has turned out for you?
Yes and no. I think I have the kind of ego, or the kind of imagination that practiced a lot. As a child and as a teenager, I would... I almost rehearsed for this kind of life, in a way. I didn't feel I belonged in one place. I always felt I had to travel, that I had places to go. I was born in a street. At the end of the street was this massive oil tanker. It was a shipyard, and they would build the biggest ships in the world. And for 9 months of the year, they'd build this huge hull above the houses. It was three times the size of the terraced houses where I live. And then they would launch it into the river, and then it would sail off into the world, never to come to port again, because they were too enormous. Really, that's a sort of symbol for my life.
When will the baby be born, do you think?
Half an hour? No. About the 25th, but I think it'll be a bit before that.
What happened today with it?
I think the head has engaged itself today. I was picking my daughter up. I suddenly felt pressure go further down. I thought, uh-oh, soon, I thought.
Mr. Jefferson. Mr. Jefferson, are you ready to start? Mr. Drew? This is in the London Mirror. Sting, milkman's son to millionaire pop superstar. The Festival of Britain was in full swing. A general election was around the corner, but for Ernie and, what's her name, Audrey, the big event in life was the birth of their ugly baby boy in 1951, Gordon Sumner.
Just wait, Branford.
Was that Gordon Matthew
Just
Sumner.
Wait.
Over here we have the three houses of Mr. Sumner, from birth to middle age to millionaire success. George Jefferson of Great Britain. Moving on up.
Moving on up.
To the east. As a schoolboy, you were hardworking, I understand. Very good, Gordy.
Gordy, oh no, Gordy.
Ladies and gentlemen, Gordy Jefferson.
We had our fun now. Just have your day, Branford.
Look at this picture. Right along with the dog-faced boy.
The dog-faced boy.
Now I ask you, is this the face of a popular millionaire superstar? Verily, I say unto thee, it is not.
I don't think it was really a black and white thing. I think it was he had to, well, there was that there. It was, but not, the major thing was the social barrier of him being British and white and us being American and black. Because the thing I noticed, a lot of black British people are still British. You know, the things that they say and the things that they do are very, very British. You know, like a British guy will have a word that describes a particular, you know, they have their colloquiums and they're national, whereas like black people, our colloquiums are very regional. Even inside of the black community, there are things that I say being from New Orleans, things that a black guy from Philadelphia would say that I wouldn't know what was going on.
Yeah. So how did you deal with it?
He tried to hang, you know. It's like one time I told him, I said, man, your music's a motherfucker, man. And he goes, my music's a motherfucker? Never really heard it called that before. It was like he got kind of pissed because I don't think he really knew that I was giving it. That's like a compliment in the highest order, right? But I think it was little things like that.
The Flintstones was one of my favorites, though, all the time. The Flintstones. With the Flintstones. You know that thing?
No.
Yes, you do.
Teach me.
All British people know the Flintstones. That's a lie.
When you're with the Flintstones.
Yeah, I know. We started singing in the wrong key.
From the town of Bad Rock, they're a place right out of history. When you're with the Flintstones, have a yammer, 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 a yammer, a yammer, a yammer, a
I had a piano in my house since I was about 7 years old. My father had me take piano lessons. My whole family took piano lessons, but everybody quit but me. He forced me to keep on. I wanted to quit, but he forced me to keep on. My mother and father are responsible for me being a musician today. And my brother's responsible for me being a jazz musician.
You know what you want to be when you grow up.
Oh,
you know what I want to do when I grow up?
What you want to be?
I want to be like a Las Vegas singer. That to me is the epitome. I mean, this bass stuff, look, really, this bass stuff is just some very primary shit. This is just to get me started because there is nothing I would like more to have like a 24-piece band playing some great tune like Night and Day. You are the one. I mean, that's got, hey, come on, give me, you know, that's got to be a serious brush. Gotta be a serious brush. A little red wine, folks. Enjoy your dinner. New York, New York, if I can make it there, I'll make it anywhere. It's up to you.
Okay, we've got two more days of rehearsal before we have to do the show. And let's just do some tightening up. I think on Set Them Free, I'm still not happy with the first chorus. It just doesn't lift, doesn't sort of go anywhere.
Same with Shadows.
Approchez, approchez, s'il vous plaît. Le parc de Courson est un des lieux les plus romantiques, créé vers 1820 par Berthaud. Oui, madame. Le château a été construit vers la fin du XVIIe siècle. Parmi les châtelains, Jean-Thomas Arrigui de Casanova, proche cousin de Napoléon, grâce à lui, le château s'est enrichi de souvenirs personnels de l'empereur qu'on peut voir dans le cabinet à la droite de l'entrée. Voici le portrait de Casanova, Monsieur Padoue, dans son uniforme de général d'Empire. Ici le grand salon qui fait
here. Staying in the center here.
Well, I just think the drums are too far away. I mean, I need some eye contact with him. What's the limit you can bring him down to for the lights?
I don't know. I'll have to have a look. I'd say two steps. You got any more than two steps, kill me. How long does it take you to refocus the whole lot of them? It's not a question of no light can go in front of the fire curtain in this building. Everything has to be behind it. And the set's behind, and now you want to move everything forward, which means you're moving out of the light. So we can move a little bit, of course.
Let's move it two steps. And if it's...
Well, the problem is, if you're looking straight, trying to look at the drummer, and you're looking straight in the lights.
Only a periscope is there.
That's enough. That's enough. That was two.
It's only one.
No, that was two.
That was
two. Believe me,
that was one.
It was two.
That's great. I like it.
Trudy, if you go into labour at 8 o'clock,
yes.
Well, would you mind having the baby on there?
No, I can do it.
Bill, well, Derek.
You can't say that. You can't say that. You can't.
still coming up in the same channel?
Definitely. One where he looks great. One where I look great. Now, who are you exposing? Me or him? Me.
What he does, pop music, Sting is like the best musician out there today. Music is a tremendous social statement. Musicians are always social critics. And that's the biggest problem with pop music, is that they don't have any more social critics. They're not enough, they don't have enough people with the intelligence or the balls to stand up and see the world for what it is and say, man, this shit is out. They're so busy worrying about making money. You know, like, you see very few people now who say, I want to be a rock and roll musician. Sting is a throwback in a sense because he's worried about music. He wants to be a musician. The fact that he's even trying a project like this shows a lot of credit.
I really respect his skill as a composer. And so I watch how he pieces things together, as a lyricist as well. Yeah. How he does tell a story with lyrics in there. And I've never heard a song that was a nothing song.
I might have changed the way they play. For example, in jazz, in the jazz club, a soloist is allowed maybe three or four verses to warm up his solo, so he makes this organic curve. And he's allowed to wander around and find this avenue and jettison that and go somewhere else. In rock music, you have to burn from the first bar.
And that's the problem for me, you see, is that I have to go and be brutal with the manager and get heavy with the group and say, hey, come on, guys, you're asking for too much. There's just money isn't there. And they're saying, how much money's on the table, man? I said, yeah, but that's Sting's table. That's not your table. You know, and you argue with somebody saying, look, we got Madison Square Garden sold out. Now, if you canceled the show, speaking to any one of the musicians, if you canceled the show and you weren't going to show up and they bring a replacement, how many people are going to give their tickets back? No one. That doesn't mean you're not a brilliant musician, and I don't love you as a person. I don't think you're great. But the fact is that your market value in terms of the kid buying the ticket, you know, he isn't going to pay to see you. Now, if Sting cancels and isn't going to show up, but you four guys are going to be on the stage, how many people do you think are going to cancel? Every one of them. Now, how do you relate? You know, your fee at this and Sting's fee. What's on the table isn't your table.
I bet you it comes on the 21st.
You in?
I want to change my day.
It's a boy. The 19th.
Hey, that's my day.
Oh, come on, man. That's what you said?
Hey, no, I didn't. Read that paper.
I said the 19th. I
keep it. Where's your money,
honey? Don't put the bridge
in. I said 80.
Whoever's the closest wins, right?
Schizo.
Anybody else?
21st.
Schizo.
I'll pay you tomorrow.
Yeah, right.
What the fuck is wrong with you?
Do that again.
Expression. Yes, he has fashion. I think it's my first, don't you?
Max is one of these wonderful madmen who bring out the fool in everyone else. He's the creative fool. Max works in an interesting way. It's so disarming, the way he photographs you, that you're forced, really, to drop the mask. You know, when you're photographed, you have maybe three expressions. There's that one. There's that one, the nice guy, you know. When you see it in all the front covers I'm on, you know, there's one of three expressions. Max has found a new sting just by disorientating me, by chasing me through fields, or me chasing him.
Not drab people. I mean, they should be a bit more flamboyant. You don't see anybody walk on stage from Liberace to some country singer that doesn't dress. We did a show, Synchronicity. We spent $400,000 going. They were wearing white. But the point is that there's no contrast. You've got this soul art. You might as well have a black. You know, I mean, why don't we film in black and white?
If I add bits of color to everybody's clothes, I think it'll work.
Something that your mind can focus on. You can't focus on a loose suit the same color as the background.
Our original concept in meetings with Sting were all a very minimal kind of thing. He was talking about he wanted it to be Brechtian.
Well, the chateau was very drab.
The chateau was not drab.
Did you see the rushes?
I've seen every single
set of
rushes.
Well, I've seen the rushes, and they look pretty drab to me.
I don't think that's true.
Yes, but this should be colorful and exciting. It's been watered down. I mean, what's ended up here is a watered-down look.
It's not watered down.
It's refined to the point where it's lost interest. You have to have some rough edges in it.
I mean, I don't want the clothes
to look that way. You sound like you've gone so far to avoid what things are looking like, you've forgotten what the whole basic element of what it is it's all about.
No, I haven't.
In my view, this looks boring. The girls look boring. Come on, those are colorful girls. They're boring.
No, they're not.
Well, I'm sorry. I'm just a peasant, man, but I'm telling you, they look boring to me.
Is in competition with probably the greatest act in history, the Police. That's the risk.
Does that make you nervous?
Yes, a little.
I think the management and record company are frightened of him going too far. I think I asked one of the executives what this album meant to the record company, and he just looked out and said, salvation.
So what's riding on opening night?
Sting's career? No, I don't think it's that.
It's that much. But I think what's riding on Wednesday night is just the audience, the first audience that's paid to see and hear this band and Sting perform these songs with him. And I think they're going to love it.
Yes, the record company were perturbed. Yes, my management were perturbed. The general public were probably perturbed when they heard this word jazz mentioned. But that's not what we've made. We haven't made jazz. Nothing to do with jazz.
People have talked about the risk of this project a lot. I don't think the risk is necessarily in the music he's chosen. The risk is being only on his own, where there's no cocoon, where every interview has to be done by him. Whereas in the Police, he would only do a quarter of the interviews because the others would carry the bulk of it. Everything now was Sting. The pressure, it's the pressure is the important difference between this situation and the one he was in the Police.
Well, I haven't jettisoned the songs I wrote for the Police. I still perform them. They're still my songs and they still have a life. And they've been reinterpreted for this band. And when people come to the concert, I wouldn't say to them, you're not going to hear anything that you expect or you want. I've given them 50% of what they wanted to hear, which is the hits, but also 50% of the material they didn't know. And that is fairly unique for an established artist to do. No one goes out into a concert hall and does material the audience doesn't know. It's a big risk.
No, man, I don't think we need the umbrella.
Hey, man.
Where's the...
My Mel out here. Where's the brother?
Come on. Come on.
Hey, bro.
Come I heard the news.
Yeah, nice.
Huh?
Nice.
Go for it, man.
I had to go buy something for the suits, right?
This is cool.
That's nice.
This won't fit under a suit.
It won't? Yeah, that suit's so big, man. I can fit my mom in that suit with me.
The problem with the costume was that it was gray and the stage is gray, or it looks gray. It washes out. So then they tried to give me a shirt that matches with the suit, or something that'll bring the suit out.
Now they changed the color of the stage. Now it's pink.
They did? Oh, great. It's the one thing I like about playing with Sting, though. We can look like men, play a gig, instead of looking like a bunch of fags.
How's Trudy?
Well, Trudy's going into labor.
So much for that bet.
Right? Yeah, I won the bet, but...
You won the bet?
We got a midwife backstage.
I mean, I think that's a good space to be in, to have some nervous energy. It, so many times that first night is the best night because of that nervous energy.
Mini, 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 me. Mini, 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 me.
Hi,
Trudy.
Hey, girl.
Hello,
lady. How are you?
How are you?
Good luck, Trudy.
Good luck.
Break
good
your
luck.
Legs. Good
luck. Break a...
See you later.
Come on, mama.
Okay.
Bye. If I was Sting, I might be nervous, but I'm not Sting. I play jazz. I know what it's like to be shat on. You know what I mean? So it's not like I am a jazz musician. I know what it's like to play some stuff that nobody wants to hear.
Are you nervous?
Mm-mm. About my high heels, but that's about it.
Let's go.
What's that time, huh?
encircled you in trenches and barbed wire. Then let me build a bridge, for I cannot fill the chasm. And let me set the battlements on fire. Under the ruins of a walled city, crumbling towers and beams of yellow light, no flags of truce, no cries of pity, siege guns pounding through the night. It took a day to build the city. We walked through its streets in the afternoon. As I returned across the fields I'd known, I recognized the walls that I'd once made. Had to stop in my tracks for fear of walking on my mind's eye late. And if I built this fortress around your heart, encircled you in trenches and barbed wire, let me build a bridge, I cannot fill the chasm. Let me set the battlements on.
Cheap and clean, grimy faces were never seen. Deadly
not gonna be a rock star. That's not gonna be a problem. This band could be very big, but I'm not a rock star. I'm a musician. I'm not star material. I'm not here to be a star. You know, I'm not gonna do the things that are necessary to become a star. I'm not gonna say the right things. I'm not gonna have the right smile. I'm not gonna go to the right functions because that's not what my vibe is. Just from being around Sting in this short period of time and meeting all of those guys and all these stars walked in, oh man, I wanted to bark, you know? And that's not because I don't have any respect for some of their work, but it's just an attitude that pervades when they come around, and that's not my attitude. That's not what I'm put on the earth to be or be a part of.
The shade of your parasol and your love flows through me. Though I drink at your pool, I burn for you. I burn for you and I. Time falls around our bed, in peace we sleep entwined, and your love flows through me. The wide ocean soothes my head, I burn for you, I burn. when the lights are low. And it's time to go. That's when I need your love so bad.
I think that this band could knock some walls down. You know what I mean? Of jazz, rock, whatever.
And there's no greater feeling than just blowing other bands away. It's a really, 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 it's a good feeling. This band has a musical impact that I haven't seen in pop music in a long time, because they can just, everybody can play the instruments and just cream all the other bands, beat the shit out of all the other bands, you know?
Is there any one moment in your life when you knew you were going to get what you dreamed about?
Yes. It was the first time I was lying in bed in a hotel in the north of England. We'd just done a concert. And our first record was in the charts. And a window cleaner was whistling Roxanne. And that was it. I almost wept. Because I realized that he was whistling a tune that I'd written. It's something that I had composed in my front room for no other purpose but to amuse myself. And there was this window cleaner. And I had a very similar experience in the hospital after Jake had been born, where one of the orderlies was whistling Walking on the Moon as he walked past the door. It's a full circle, really. It's a great privilege for that to happen to you.
Seeing your son born mean to you?
More than I thought it would. It made me appreciate my other children as well. What a miracle they are. It's very easy to come in after the fact and they're all clean and they're all in their nice white nightgowns and their hair's brushed. But the reality is much more bloody and profound.
Я обещаю, что мы будем с вами встречаться.